Hi and welcome back. We have already covered quite some functionalities within the Earth Engine, and last time we saw how to import external data. This time we will explore the functions that let you use data obtained within the Earth Engine outside of the tool. Then you can make proper maps of the data or even continue performing calculations with other software you like. So the Earth Engine has four export possibilities. When you search in the docs for export, these will appear. The two major data types, being raster data and vector data, can be exported with the function export image and export table respectively, and then two more functions exist. Export map will put your data into a format that is suitable for web applications using the Google Maps API or Google Earth Online. I won't go into detail about this, as it is very specific and eventually doesn't let you use your data on your computer. The fourth function is export video, and this converts an image collection to a video. This can be useful when you want to visualize changes over time, for example. For each exporting possibility, there are three more options. You can export the object to your assets. We have used this in the previous video as well, and this stores the image online, so you can use it in other scripts. A second option is to export your object to cloud storage. This is a paid service from Google, and it's a professional cloud storage that you can access using an API, which makes it great for using it in custom applications. The last option is to export the data to your Google Drive, where you can download it to your device. All of these functions take a large amount of variables, most of these are optional, but I will go over them one by one so they become clear to you. We'll start by exporting a single image to our assets. When we look at the docs to see what the required parameters are, we can see that actually only the image is required, and everything else is optional. There are default values for all other parameters. Let's see what happens when we leave everything as default. After that, I will go over the other variables to see what other options you have. Executing a function will create a new task, and when you run the task, you will get asked some of the commonly used parameters again. But they are already filled in, and I will leave them as they are. So when the task has executed, we can add the assets to the script again to compare the results. A first thing that you might see is the loss of resolution. The default option for resolution is 1000 meters per pixel, but Landsat comes at 30 meters per pixel. So that alone is already a reason to look into the parameters. So I'll do this export again, but this time I'll go over all possible variables. When you add a lot of variables into a function, you can list all of them between the brackets, but this quickly gets unclear. A better solution is to list it in a dictionary. When you do this, it also does not matter in what order you put the parameters. So I'll go back to the docs real quick to copy the possible variables. And first we have the description. This is, in contrast to what it sounds like, actually the name of your asset. You should make sure it does not contain any white spaces. Next is the asset ID, and this is the ID of your file, and it will be stored under this name. Then the pyramiding policy will determine how pixels are generalized when you zoom out. When zooming out, the software will have to group pixels together, as you can't display each single pixel forever. This hierarchy of displaying and grouping pixels can be compared to a pyramid structure, hence the name. It speeds up the loading of images because you don't have to download and display each pixel when you are only looking at a larger image. The default pyramiding policy is to take the mean of all cells when grouping them. This should be sufficient unless you have a specific goal in mind that requires something else. Then you can decide to group some pixels by the minimum value, the maximum value, a most occurring value, or just take a sample. If you specify this, you will have to list all the bands you want to apply it to in a dictionary, or you can change the default policy like so. With the dimension, you can specify the dimension of the exported image. This does not change the size of the image, but rather how many pixels the image will contain. I'm not really sure how this works, and what the difference is with choosing a scale, and I can't find more information online, but I haven't had the need to use it either. If anyone knows what it does specifically, let me know. You can also specify a geometry, and then the bounding box of that geometry will be the extent of the exported image. By default, this is set to the view you are currently in, which is very confusing. If, for example, you have zoomed in on a part of your image while exporting, only the part you can see will be exported if you leave this variable as default. I have already created a small region to use. If you wish, you can define the scale of the image, which is the same as the resolution. This is, as mentioned already, set to 1000 meters per pixels initially. But since we know that Landsat imagery comes at 30 meters per pixel, we can choose this for the best image quality. It is also possible to change the coordinate reference system as well. By default, it will be the same as the image you start from, but you can change this to whatever you like. In this example, I will take a reference system specifically for Uganda. You can also change the transformation that the Earth engine should use for changing the reference system, but this is not required. If you want to look up the correct code, you need to enter for reference system. I'll put a link to that in the description. And the last variable you can change is the maximum amount of pixels in the export. Initially, it is set to 100 million, or 10 to the 8. You will get an error if you exceed this value. You can set this value higher or lower in case you want to export a larger image or restrict yourself from downloading too much. You have to make sure you type the parameters correctly. And when we run the task, we can compare the result again. These are all the possible arguments you can define when exporting an image to your assets. Many of the following functions use the same arguments, so I will be able to go over them much faster. I will skip the option of exporting data to cloud storage. This is similar to Google Drive, but with an extensive API and scalability to exabytes of data. This makes it actually better suited for applications rather than personal use. I've never used this, but the possible parameters are similar to the ones mentioned already, and additional parameters seem well explained as well. Then a third exporting possibility is to export to your Google Drive. This is what you will be using when you want to download data to your computer, or you want to easily share the files with others. Again, only the image is a required argument, and everything else is optional. The only parameters that are different from the export to asset functions are the folder, a file name prefix, a shard size, file dimensions, the option to skip empty tiles, and info on the file format. First of all, the folder. Let's say I have a folder in my Google Drive named GEE data. Then I can type this here and my results will be stored in that folder. If the specified folder does not exist, it will automatically create a new one with that name. The file name prefix is a file name that will be used for the export. By default, this is set to what you have typed in the description. The shard size is some internal measure and eventually does not affect your export. It determines the amount of pixels that the Earth engine will process at a time. The amount of pixels does not have to form a square, it can be any number. It is only important when regarding the next parameter, the file dimension. If you want to put an upper limit to the amount of pixels one image can contain, you can define it here. The image will then be split into multiple images that eventually make up the exported image. But here it is important that the amount of pixels in a single file is a multiple of the shard size. If, for example, Google Earth Engine handles 100 pixels at a time, as could be defined with the shard size, you cannot ask for an image containing 110 pixels, but you could create a file with 200 pixels, which consists of two shards. That's why this has to be a multiple of the shard size. These different images are then named after the file name prefix that you possibly defined, followed by the coordinates of that tile. If you mark skip empty tiles as true, it will not write data from tiles that are fully masked. So tiles that are not regarded in your export won't be computed. There are two supported file formats, the first one being GeoTIFF or TF-Record. TF-Record is only used as input for TensorFlow, a machine learning tool, so GeoTIFF is what you most likely will be using for exporting. This is also the default setting. You can enter specific parameters for the format, but this is mostly for exporting TF records. If you are exporting such files, you might want to check the docs for the possible options. And that's everything you can know about exporting rasters in the Google Earth Engine. If you get an error like this, when the data type seems to be incompatible, you need to cast the data type of the image to a specific format. What usually works is just to cast the image as a float. And now we try it again. And now the image appears in our folder. Exporting vectors is even easier. When you export it to your assets, you can only define the collection to export, a description, and an ID. All of these we have discussed already. And even when exporting to your drive, no additional parameters are required, except for the drive-specific fields that are also mentioned for rasters. Exporting vectors is possible in a wider variety of formats. You can choose between a CSV file, a GeoJSON, KML, KMZ, a shapefile, or again a TF record. Also, regular tables with data can be exported like this, then the items will just have no geometry. You do not have to export all columns of a table or vector, you can select the ones of interest with the selector parameter. Then the last item I will cover is the option to export image collections to a video. This can be useful for when you have extracted a time series and conveniently want to display changes. As an example, I will simply display a time series of Landsat images. This is again similar to exporting an image to your drive, but there are two new variables. For this function, it is important that your image collection only has images with three bands, a red, blue, and green band. If this is not the case, you need to select only those three bands. You also need to use certain variable types. If this is not the case, you will probably get an error and you will have to cast it as an 8-bit integer, for example. So a first new variable is the frame rate at which the video will be exported. So this is how many seconds an image will be shown in the video. And secondly, you can set an upper limit of the amount of frames the video can contain. By default, your video can contain 1000 frames, but you can set this lower or higher as you like. So that were all possible ways you can export images, vectors, tables, or image collections. If something was unclear, let me know, I'd be happy to help.